Well, actually, I now say good evening, everybody, don't I? Not good afternoon. Well, thank you for that wonderful introduction. That's great. I am going to talk about creativity, and in fact, if I do that, I've written a little book on the creative process, and the reason I'm an art director, actually, I don't normally do writing. I take words out, you know, art directors, get rid of the words, get rid of the... But I've now found myself writing books. But actually, I decided that I would write this book because I've heard and I was reading so much rubbish about the creative process. And usually, it was written by somebody who actually isn't engaged in a creative profession. So they were constantly observing creativity. And I kept reading this stuff, and I thought, God almighty, this person's obviously never had an idea in their life, and they've never executed an idea. So the subject of the book, as you can rightly see, is called Hegarty on Creativity, and There Are No Rules. The great thing about calling the book There Are No Rules is you can then disagree with everything I say, and I say, well, I told you there are no rules. So it becomes rather easy. But I'm going to try and leave you with three, hopefully, profound thoughts about the creative process and creativity, along with a few others as well. But the first thing I really want to say, and this is really, really important, is that sitting on a beanbag does not make you creative, all right? Now, you know, again, you know, when the media want to comment on a kind of creative environment, they usually have people sitting around on a beanbag. They usually got a beanie on, and they probably got a laptop as well. Sorry, those with laptops, don't worry about it. I can assure you, the last place you're ever going to have an idea is sitting on a beanbag. It is actually the most uncomfortable thing you'll ever do. So, you know, if you think you're going to have a wonderful time with doing that, then you probably won't. But as I said, I'm going to kind of define creativity, and I think that's fundamentally important from my point of view. I'm going to talk about having a creative philosophy, and I'm going to say, which might be anathema to an awful lot of you, why you should be removing the headphones, all right? So, if I can leave you with those three things, as well as some others, I hopefully will be able to spur your imagination. So, I mean, I think when we come to talk about creativity, you have to define what it is. What do you mean? And there are lots of definitions. You can have, you know, a number of people have defined it in a number of ways. Somebody once said to me a long time ago, music is the greatest of all art forms. And actually, I debated with him. I said, I disagree with that, actually. I don't think it is the greatest of all art forms. I think it's the second greatest of all art forms. And the greatest is life. Life is the greatest of all art forms. So therefore, I define creativity as an expression of self. We're all creative, you know, everybody's creative. This idea that some people are creative and some aren't, and you know, I work in a business where people say to me, oh, John, you're creative, so therefore, we're all creative. That's fundamentally important that we realize that. Mind you, there is that wonderful line that says, we're all artists, but some of us shouldn't exhibit, which I do actually buy into in a very, very big way. But the fact that we're all creative is fundamental, and everything stems from that. Everything that my beliefs come from that point of view, it's an expression of self. Now, I'm going to say something again. There are two types of creativity. And if you're organizing a creative company, it's very important to understand this. There are two types of creativity. There's pure creativity, and there's applied creativity. Now, what do we mean by pure creativity? Pure creativity is, I don't know, painting the Mona Lisa. Is Matt Groening thinking up The Simpsons? Or it's Frank Gehry's Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. Pure examples of pure creativity. Applied creativity is perhaps writing the 32nd episode of The Simpsons. Or it's working out how the staircases function in the museum in Bilbao. applied, pure and applied. Now, the point about that, and it's a fundamental point, is the people who by and large, and this is, I'm generalizing slightly here, but the people who are applied pure creativity will not go to a brainstorm session. There is no point in asking them to go to a brainstorm session. Oh, by the way, there is actually no proof whatsoever that a brainstorm session has given us anything great. It gets us to good. And if you're interested in good, that's fine. You know, that's perfectly okay. If you want to do something great, do not go to a brainstorm session. It is a complete waste of time. The applied creative people will need to kind of sit in meetings and talk about, you know, with structural engineers, how we get that staircase to work or whatever it is. Or if you're writing the 32nd episode of The Simpsons, you kind of work, your characters are all defined, you then play with them and see how you can get them to be better. That's really, really fundamentally important. But, and you talk to people when they're organizing creative organizations and they do not understand that. They try and get people who are involved in pure creativity to go to, you know, collaboration meetings. You know, it's another one of those fucking words that we have to put up with. Collaboration, it's the bane of our lives. Of course we collaborate on all kinds of things, but to think a great idea is going to come out of collaboration, almost certainly not. You work with one or two people, yes, that's great. Now, I'm doing this very quickly because I've only got a short period of time. I believe the foundation of all creativity is ideas. Now, it may sound a bit obvious to say that, but it's one of those things where people do not realize that actually, before the creative process starts, you've got, or it's part of it, is you have to have an idea. Now, I come from an industry which is obsessed with ideas. If you walk around the corridors of BBH, you'll hear people saying, so what's the idea? And it's from that that we then build an execution, an expression of that idea that communicates. My belief is if it doesn't have an idea in it, it's decoration. And decoration's fine. You know. I personally think Mark Rothko is decoration. You know, I mean, the fact that he can get 20 million a canvas for decoration, I think is absolutely genius. But, you know, I wish I could do that. But I view that as decoration. And what's brilliant about ideas, and I'll move on from there, is that anybody can have them. Anytime, anywhere, any moment. You don't need special permission, you don't need special equipment, you don't need certain tools. You can do it anywhere. In fact, I do my best thinking when I'm not thinking, which is one of those things that happens. And I think that is brilliant, and we should recognize that. It's the most wonderful, egalitarian thing that happens. And I can assure you, let me assure you, there aren't many people in North Korea allowed to have ideas. That's what you've always got to remember. So, ideas are at the foundation of all creativity. Fundamental to that. the other thing is, I think whatever creative profession you're in, whatever you're doing, you have to have a philosophy. You know, you don't just become a creative person operating in a creative profession. You have to decide, what do you believe in? What are you trying to communicate? What are you actually saying? Because if you remember, I said creativity is an expression of self. So what is it you're trying to say? And I don't care what business you're in, whether you're, you know, a graphic designer doing soap powder packs, you have a point of view. No piece of pure creativity is ever done by somebody just sitting down and doing something. You know, a novelist doesn't sit down and just write a book, or a painter doesn't just paint a picture. They have a point of view. And as a creative person, you've got to work out, what is it? What is your point of view? What do you believe in? Fundamentally important that. Personally, and I kind of sort of discovered it really, was through my own work and stuff I liked. I loved irreverence. And I realized when I was asked by somebody, well, what is it you believe in, John? What is it you look for in a great idea? I realized what I loved was irreverence. I thought that was fantastic. And that, in a way, has skewered all my work. Everything I've done is about irreverence. So that really turns me on. But, you know, whatever you are, whatever you do, you will have to find your point of view. Now, you don't Google it, Google philosophy, what have I got? It'll come through your work. You'll see it and feel it in your work. So fundamentally important that you develop a philosophy. And I think the session before this was talking about storytelling, and I'm just going to make one small point about storytelling, and that how fundamental it is in the creative process. I mean, virtually everything we do is telling a story. And the reason why, it's even more profound than we possibly think. And I, if there's one thing that I would advise you, please do read a book called From Animals to Gods, The Making of Humankind. I think it's actually been re-released as Sapiens, but anyway, if you Google that, you'll get it. And what's amazing about this, and why storytelling is so incredible, is we are Homo sapiens, right? We are the only breed in the world where there is only one version of us. We're just Homo sapiens. Neanderthal's gone, Homo erectus gone, we're the only ones. Every other kind of breed in the world, there are a great number of them. So monkeys, chimpanzees, cats, whatever it might be. Nobody knows why that is. But the important thing is that somewhere in our development, we evolved fictive language. And that was the great leap. Fictive language. In other words, we developed the ability to have ideas and think about things that were beyond just pure information. Chimpanzees talk. Oh, look, banana. Watch out, tiger. And the point about that is, when they get to about 50, they have to break up and go into smaller groups. Because we developed fictive language, we could live in larger and larger groups. So, the very essence of villages, towns, and cities, and nations comes from the fact that we were able to develop fictive language. It is so fundamental that, you know, we must never go past that. But do read the book. It's absolutely brilliant. It's the best, one of the best books I've read all year. So storytelling, as we all know, has always been important, but it's even more fundamental than that. It is why we are in this group together, because of storytelling. The other thing I'm just going to very quickly talk about is we often talk about the power of fame and why fame is important. Now, I know a lot of people will sort of go, oh dear me, don't like that fame. Don't we live in a fame culture? No, do not get fame and celebrity confused. I think the dictionary defines fame as public renown, great esteem. And the reason why fame is important in the creative process is that you're trying to develop a kind of rapport with your audience. You're trying to develop a kind of means of conducting a conversation. And the more famous your work is, the more it's known, the more interesting that conversation can be. So, you know, when I look at a piece of Picasso's work, because I know of him, because I know what he was saying, I understand many more things from that work. Now, that's brilliant, and that's wonderful, and that's what we're trying to develop. However, there is the other side of it is it can then typecast you. All of a sudden, you know, you're only known for one piece of type of work, and that can put you in a straitjacket, which can reduce your creativity. So you have to have the courage, in a way, to break out of your own fame. Your fame can become a trap. We can see that, especially with actors. You know, I do not want to be known as just that one type of actor. Daniel Craig doesn't want to go on playing James Bond because he'll be typecast. He'll have to break out of that. Fame, fundamentally important, but it will become something that could trap you. My next point, and this is one of the big points, is please remove the headphones. Now, the reason I say this is that most creative careers have about 10 years. 10 years and you do your great work. That's it. A bit depressing that if you're just coming out of art school and you're, you know. But it's true. Most creative careers, 10 years. Now, if you're Mick Jagger, you go around the world singing Jumping Jack Flash and, you know, 20,000 people turn up and applaud. Well, wrote that in 1968 or something like that. That's okay for him. A lot of creative people in a lot of careers, especially ours, in the world I come from, you have to come in every day and you have to have a new idea. And that idea can't be like yesterday's idea. You've got to constantly reinvent, constantly recreate. And that's very difficult. So how do you do that? How are you going to take a 10-year career, turn it into a 15-year career, 20, 30-year career. Right. First of all, you have to accept, do the things I'm talking about. You have to understand philosophy. You have to understand what creativity is. You have to understand, too, that you're a transmitter, and that what you're doing is you're getting all this information all around you, all the time. It's feeding in, and it comes back out again. As soon as you put the headphones on, you're cutting yourself off. So why are you cutting yourself off for inspiration? And it comes at you when you're least expecting it. All the time, it's out there. You look, you know, and things will happen. So, you know, removing the headphones, fundamentally important. So that's the first thing you've got to do. Ego, fundamentally important. Some people think it isn't. You know, ego is I believe in this. And you want ego. Ego is fundamental. That's what you are. That's who you are. That's what makes you creative. I am believing in this. Now, some people say they don't want ego, but you do. Now, the danger is what you don't want is to become an egotist. And that leads to hubris, which can be very, very dangerous. So, you know, we don't want to become involved in hubris. And that will destroy you. The other thing that you've got to, the other thing is don't become a cynic. Cynicism is the death of creativity. The other thing that happens somehow in your creative career, you have to kind of find a way of getting somebody who you can bounce your ideas off. Your fame will, in some senses, as I already said, destroy you. So, you know, every McCartney needs a Lennon is my title in this one. And, you know, when McCartney had Lennon, he was writing Eleanor Rigby and Yesterday and God knows what else. And then when he was on his own, he was writing The Mull of Kintyre and The Frog Song. I think that proves my point, really, doesn't it? You know, that I'm sure if Lennon had been around, he'd have said, hey, Paul, I wouldn't do The Frog Song, you know. You know, but it's the great problem that we have is as you become more successful, you're distanced from the people who can really talk to you and really can guide you and help you. And that's one of the great conundrums of a creative profession, because it's about opinion, it's a point of view. But that will seriously destroy you. And my very last point is ultimately great ideas are about simplicity. Now, the reason I say this is, you know, we're in Europe, this is technology and all those things. There's only one space. There is only one thing that I'm trying to occupy, and that is the space between somebody's ears. That's the only space worth talking about. Everything is how we get there. How do I get into somebody's head? That's what I'm trying to do. And simplicity is fundamentally important, because what you want to do is you want to get the idea into somebody's head. And that's where you want it to open out. Not on the page, not on the phone, not on the screen. Not on, you want it to open out inside their head. Then you've got a truly stunning and fantastic idea. So thank you very much. That's a quick run through it. Thanks a lot.